Please, the head, introducing this plenary session. It's the first one of the European days of the summer days. And I wanted to tell you quite a lot of people contributed to the day, the workshops, the fora this morning. I hope you appreciate it. And this afternoon we spent together. And I wanted to invite you with us, Rena Butikova, who is the president of the European Green Party. Please applaud him tonight, because he's at the origin of the plenary tonight. At the same time, you please applaud the people who are going to come and present this. Then there are two people you already know who contributed quite a lot to the success of this day, so Gwendolyn Delbos-Coffin and Thierry Bouchot. And on top of that, we have two other people who are paid people, and you're not going to meet them. And Armin Trott and Anna Yudasieva, who spent the whole summer working to organize this day. I cannot see them. And as you can see, she's pregnant. So thank you very much. And we can also thank the translators, and thank you. Thank you for being there. For us, it's very important to organize these days, not only because it's in Strasbourg, but also because we have the European elections in front of us, but also it's the second edition of the day. We're very happy about the partnership. The ecologist family has been existing for a long time, and we do not only carry together and bear the importance of the European Union, but we also have the same fights, whatever the country is, and it's the same battles the ecologists have to improve the living conditions of everybody. As such, the Green Party is 24 years old, created in 2004, and we work together. We have been working together for a long time, especially for the preparation, on the preparations of the European elections, and we hope that we're going to campaign throughout the year. And so I try to explain what the European Green Party hopes for. And I'm going to ask Emily Witterbroek, who is the former Belgian minister and member of the executive committee of the European Party, Marianne Serre, who is the general secretary, and she's from Catalonia. Thank you very much, Marie. The theme of this campaign will be the climatic changes. And our mission is to heat the room, to introduce the panel. So we're going to, Ma and I are going to try and do. We wanted to talk to you about this campaign. The European Green Party has already started, and started a few months ago, because it's going to be an excessively important campaign, not only for the ecologists, but also for the whole of Europe. You know that today there are things going back, populisms, and questions about the future of Europe. And we think that maybe the ecologists have the most coherent, most pro-European party. And We are in favor of Europe, not the Europe we know today, but we have a project which is very optimistic and resolutely constructive and motivating. So we were asked to do a few things on this campaign, on the practical side of the campaign. Our objective at the Green, at the European Green Party, is to give to our parties, give tools, certain tools, but basically to ensure the coordination and collaboration between all the Green parties throughout Europe so that our voice can be heard, whether from Austria to France to Ireland to Greece, talk with our own values, our own tools, so that we have links and networks. So we've had a team which is very motivated in Brussels, and we have worked not only with the Secretariat, but also with all the member countries, our delegates, the presidents of the various parties. We've been working on the manifesto, which is in our program of this European Green Party, and it will be made available to various parties that we wanted, not with 100 or 60 or 100 pages like the ecologists in Belgium. Sometimes it's even bigger than that. So what we wanted is to have a manifesto and a program which was rather brief, with 10 priorities. It's about 15 pages. It has to be adopted in Berlin in November, and it will then be circulated and made available. This is the work we are doing at the moment on the program. Apart from that, we also hold events like the Action Days on specific days, on specific themes which speak to us European ecologists, because we have common values. Of course, we do have certain differences, but we also have thematics. On the 15th of October, we will have a common action cleanup day. On the 15th of September, sorry. And on the issue of plastics and oceans. So we're going to try on that day to have a common action in many countries, many European countries, by the ecologists. We already had something on the Day of the Earth, and we're going to do some later on. We have two important meetings in Brussels, Berlin and Brussels. And before, we already have the TILT network, and I'm going to talk to you later, after Mart speaks to you.
Say much, because Evelyn has explained more or less the overall of our campaign. This is the fourth common campaign that within the European Green family we are doing together. So I very much encourage you to use also our campaign that is going to be beside with the Green Member Party's campaign. So I very much encourage you, people from militants, that you call it, to use also the campaign from the European Greens, because we're going to build it together with through the working groups that already are going on. And I would also like to call you to follow this campaign and to join, if possible, to Berlin, because in Berlin, in November, we're going to elect the Spitzenkandidate, so the leading candidate that is going to represent the Green family all over Europe, of other big names that are going to give their message. We're going to have two leading candidates that are going to be elected in Berlin. So I very much encourage you to follow our campaign and then to promote our green voices all over Europe. As Evelyn said, one of the main instruments that we're going to use to communalize or like to make this campaign more jointly is going to be TILT. Some of you have already heard about it in this morning's session. TILT is a network. The French name that you use is...
Réseau.
Okay, because she said this morning in the workshop, okay, in French we don't use this word, we use the other word, so whatever. This réseau, that it's been launched slowly, but I encourage all of you to go to the website, to join TILT and to follow us on the different actions that we're going to launch, that we are already launching. Some of them are already online. You can still sign the petition for a more welcoming Europe. You can join the action on the Plastic Day on the 15th September. And we're going to have actions on anti-corruption. We're going to have actions for divestment of carbon and fossil fuels. So I very much encourage you to join TILT. And now Evelyn is going to tell us how to do it. She was very successful the last time she did it. We got a lot of... increase the numbers of followers. So I'm going to see how effective you are on this now.
Elle me met des tests, mais je ne savais pas ça. Voilà. Donc.
In fact, TILT, you're going to have some sort of an indigestion because we've already talked about it. But you will only understand the efficiency of this tool once you go on the network. In English, it's rather a movement, but it means that we are going to start another party, which is not the case. So it's not our intention anyway. So we are going to create a sort of network or community through the social network. This morning, because I was asked this question this morning, so I have to tell you immediately, because this morning I wasn't clear enough. So we're still going to have campaigns outside, door-to-door campaigns, going down to the people. And social networks are never going to replace that, but we simply know that the campaigns are somehow different. We have less tracts, less brochures. We have posters, but the social networks, we have to work with them as well. So a few months ago, we said, well, through this network, we have to open considerably, not only work amongst ecologists and green people throughout cross-border, but also address the citizens who share our values. Some of them may join us on certain of our themes. So through this network, through this TILT network, it is possible on specific campaigns, such as Plastic Day on the 15th of September, to invite citizens to join us through a petition, through maybe a donation. Why not? This is always welcome. And the idea behind it is to open up to civil society. And it's one of the means we found for some of them from our green parties already used that, and we've had results. And we have started just right now. We've already had three campaigns, let's say three action days through TILT. And it does indeed draw people we maybe would not have touched otherwise. So just go on, we have flyers, so try to see that. And you go on your smartphone and Google TILT, and then we can actually circulate the campaign we have launched. We have a few specialists who can talk about it. And now we wish you a good campaign. And we rely on you quite a lot. And I admire to see you all here at the end of August, in the middle of the holidays, under the rain, in the rain, and in Strasbourg. Thank you very much. It's very motivating. So one of them is not working. Thank you very much. Then within the European Green Party, there's a federation of parties, and they try to campaign together. That's also being ecologists, is having proposals together. But we also have the Federation of Young European Ecologists, and they also campaign. They're somehow different from the European Party, but they're also very important, and they address a different part of the population. And I would like to call Antoine Divine, who, although he is French, is part of the Young European Ecologists. Thank you very much for giving us the possibility to talk to you today. The Federation of the Young Europeans celebrates their 30 anniversaries. We were set up in 88 in Strasbourg here, and today we bring together young people from 40 member groups, and from Portugal, Scotland, Georgia, and in fact we talk to our 50,000 members in Europe and strengthen political ecologies by training all those young militants so that they can to political ecology in general. The campaign we're going to have is for the European elections is to have as many people elected as possible from our parties, so we will not be in the situation we knew in France sometimes, but the Young Ecologists, Federation of the Young Ecologists in Europe, we'll all be together and we'll be represented throughout Europe. The Federation of Young Green, European Greens, we want to have a common campaign with a common identity, common proposals. And we have three messages for sustainable Europe, for social Europe, and for welcoming and inclusive Europe. Those different messages will appear through the various organizations, and how to use them and how to implement them on site and online. Our work contributed to the preparation of the manifesto Evelyn mentioned, and we encourage all the national parties, national branches, to involve the youth so that their voices can be heard in the programs which will be implemented. For us, this campaign is a training moment. For all those who are less than 30, it's going to be one of their first campaigns. So what is very important for us is to be able to use this campaign to see what's happening abroad. We're going to encourage the mobility of our militants so that the Belgian ones, for instance, can campaign in Germany, so that the Finnish ones can campaign in Spain, and get some inspiration from that and some wealth as well from that. We're also going to have trainings, especially those dedicated to young candidates, and that's one of the important axes of our campaign. It has been so since 2009. We have encouraged young people on the lists, and some of them have been elected. And Ska Keller, all those people have been elected. All the people I mentioned have been elected either in 2009 or in 2014. And we also had Clarisse Oscar, 26, of a young elected young person as a head of the list. So we just want to do the same for the coming elections throughout Europe. The young are there, they're ready, and they're just waiting for you. So we're going to invite from next week onwards all the young candidates, whether already on the list or if they want to be on the list, to join the platform on which they can exchange amongst themselves and receive different trainings. So we hope to be able to work at the European level, as well as with the national level in France, for instance, with Europe Écologie Les Verts, to make this campaign a real success. Thank you very much. Thank you, Antoine. I wanted to add that the young ecologists, I'm a former young ecologist, so I'm very proud of it. And I think that they actually incite some daringness, some boldness in the older people. We have two female spokeswomen, and I'm very proud that you actually give so much space to women. And I hope they're going to come and see us during the campaign. The second part of this plenary is the challenges and faced by the political ecology. And what we can see in the European Union more than before is that the world is changing and maybe changing faster, faster and faster. Not only in the ecological, from the ecological point of view, because we see that natural catastrophes are getting faster and faster. So that means that most people do realize that we are facing catastrophes and that hit us directly. But also, there's also a turning point at the European level, European Union level. My generation never actually knew the episode of the European construction. We just voted for the first time for the Constitutional Treaty, Europe. And over the last few years, we're not talking about European construction, but European deconstruction. So we can also see nationalisms where identity proposals are rising all through Europe and even in Indonesia. And that shows us that the world is changing. And so between the ecological transition and digital transition, you can see that we are entering the third millennium. And this is also an issue for our way of thinking, our analysis, we have to review our project, our program, to adapt it to tomorrow's program. We cannot do it by ourselves. And when we were organizing this day, we were thinking that we have to do that, we have to think that with other Europeans. And this is why I'm going to call the speakers in the plenary to come and join me on stage. Ska Keller first. Who was, as Antoine said, one of the youngest candidates in 2009, one of the youngest elected in the European Parliament. And she won the primary elections in 2014 and co-chairperson at the European Parliament of the group. Christophe de Grise, who is with us today, he is the head of the prospective unit of the trade unions. He works on the future of work in the EU, and he's a researcher, so he speaks for researchers, not for trade unions. He wanted me to stress that. So he speaks for himself on the research institute, not the trade unions. He worked a lot on the social results of the EU and the perspectives, the social perspectives, and for Europe tomorrow. Our third speaker is Polish. He's a sociologist. He was the co-chairman of the Polish party. He's also in the European foundations, and he works in the European. He works for the Green European Journal, and. We have no title in French, but you can find it online. They give you analyses and articles which are particularly interesting, contributing to presenting the European thinking. And our last speaker is French. He's a lawyer. He specializes in the environment and law. He worked on the ERICA, for instance. He was a lecturer in environmental law. And Sébastien Mabille. Thank you, all four of you.
Ska,
you're going to be the first one.
On observe aujourd'hui, on a beaucoup échangé là-dessus pendant les trois jours qui viennent de s'écouler.
We talked a lot over the last three days. There is a risk of dislocation of Europe over the migrants flux and flow, and we saw it with the Aquarius a few weeks ago, and today we can see it with the Giotti in Italy. There is not only a crisis to welcome them and the will of the Europeans to work, living together, the principle of living together, and the inception of the migrants. And you were involved quite a lot. So my first question would be to give you, my first opportunity to you would be to give us your view on the current crisis. And maybe what can be done in the within the EU, and what can you tell us from the inside of the institution, the European institutions?
Thanks for the invitation to the French Greens. It's very nice to be here, even though the subject, now that you brought it up, might not be so optimistic. But I think really that what the newspapers might call indeed refugee crisis or something is quite symptomatic for the state of play that we have in Europe. And very often it's like what's happening is a symbol, is a symptom of a deeper problem. Because when we now look at the debate and that it's not so certain anymore that member states or anyone really would rescue people who are in need for rescuing from the Mediterranean, from the sea, then this is really a very low point that we're living at. I mean, to rescue someone from a needy situation at sea, that's a fundamental human basic thing. It's international law, it's very legal and whatever, it's a lot of laws, but it's also like something so fundamental. I mean, for so many centuries and millennia, which is currently being put into question. And I'm not sure if it was big in the French media, but in the German media, it was super big, the story about this poor British lady tourist who fell from a cruise ship into the Mediterranean. And it was a big, big story. And everyone was writing about it. And she only got rescued after 10 hours. And then the newspapers were writing like, oh my God, how terrible, 10 hours at sea. Finally, she got rescued. And what a heroic effort to rescue her. At the same time, when the Giotti, the Italian ship, is not able to land with 170 refugees rescued from the sea, at the same time when trade ships are afraid to rescue people from these tiny rubber boats among the big waves because they're afraid that they will not be able to land somewhere, it's a totally ridiculous situation and debate that we have. We're wondering whether every human life is worth to be rescued. And that is certainly something that needs a strong response from us Greens, but from anyone who thinks that this is a bit bizarre. And indeed, every human life is worth rescuing, of course. But it's a bit symptomatic for the whole discussion that we currently see in the EU. We have more and more far-right parties, which are also in government. And I don't think it makes a lot of sense to just say, okay, yeah, true, Eastern Europe, right? Hungary and Poland, what have you. It's not an Eastern European issue. it has to be looked at much, much broader. Let's just look at Austria, for example, where we have the far right in government, and the Austrians now want to close all seaports. Luckily, they don't have any to refugees. Then Italy, where we also have a far right party in power. Who's currently like Salvini doing exactly what is leading to the problem? But it's not even just the far right. We all now look at Italy, but actually Malta for years has not been doing any search and rescue at all in the Mediterranean. Has not been letting people land there, and that is led by a social democratic government, at least in name. So it's showing how the discourse also, when we talk about minorities, when we talk about anyone who can be blamed for things, is going. In Austria, which is having currently the EU presidency, the government itself is just pushing for a debate on migrants and Muslims and what have you. It's headscarves the whole day up and down. Whereas the real problems that you have in Austria are much more related to social inequalities, to poverty, to a lot of other issues, a lot of problems in the country. I mean, a normal country, but still a lot of things you can do. But the government only wants to talk about migration because that will cover up all the other problems. They don't have to talk about economy, or they actually do really bad social cuts, but they will blame it on the migrants. Like, it's a total cover-up story, and that we see in other areas as well. Hungary, same thing. Orban will blame migrants for everything, except for there aren't really any in Hungary. So that is something that that is really symptomatic for the political debate, unfortunately, in a lot of places, if not almost everywhere in Europe, and even places that have been spared so far, like Spain, are now catching up. As soon as the conservatives are now in the opposition, they are starting to use migration as the topic and excuse for everything. So that is something that we certainly need to counter. But it also means that we have to address the symptoms, but also go further to the core of it, to put into the center of the debate the equality of all human beings, that we understand that it's not just the rights of some other people somewhere far away that are being attacked, but it's the rights of all of us that are being attacked. It's always starting with the weakest, so to say, like the ones who don't have voting rights, who maybe don't speak the language. You know, you can talk about refugees, you don't have to talk with them. They're, so to say, the weakest link in our society. But then it will always spread out to other groups that are a bit minority or that are a bit too female or whatever. So this is just the beginning of things. And it also means that we have to look at the way how democracies are turning, as we can see it in Poland. And Adam, of course, knows everything about that, and probably will tell us more dreadful stories from Poland, where the independence of the judiciary is totally in question, if not even like thrown out of the window. Or in Hungary, where NGOs that help refugees are being receiving money from other organizations like the Green Bell Foundation, for example, they are getting huge stickers at their outside doors, you know, being marked at the doors for being foreign infiltrators. So this is the state of play that we currently see in Europe. But I would like not to stop at this rather bleak outlook. I think this also gives us not just the opportunity, also really the need to get organized better and to do exactly what Marie said earlier, namely to look for allies, because we're not alone. And very often you get into the situation that you think, oh shit, I'm sitting in this maybe local council hall and there's a debate about whether there should be a refugee center in town, and you think, oh my God, I'm the only one here who thinks that actually it's really cool if, you know, if we help people. And then you sit there and you're too afraid to speak up. But once you do, actually, then very often there will be other people who say, yes, I agree with you, because they themselves have been too afraid to speak up because they think they're alone. But we're not alone in the room. We're not alone in Europe. There's so many organizations be it in Hungary that care for refugees, be it in Poland, people go on the street, be it in Romania against corruption, be it in Austria, be it everywhere, like so many people, organized or not organized, who are not happy the way that Europe's turning, who want a different Europe of solidarity, of social rights, a welcoming Europe. And we have to not just help those people, that's a bit paternalistic, but also really engage with them and connect with them, to all of us have that idea that we're not alone, but we actually might very well be in the majority. We just haven't discovered it yet.
Thank you, Scott. What you just said echoes what one of our other speakers, Sophie, discussed on Thursday regarding social inequalities and environmental inequalities. She said that we had to stop working for people and talking about people, but try and working with people, especially the most vulnerable. Perhaps the lack of a social Europe is one of the reasons for the crisis regarding the welcome that we have reserved for migrants and the way we live together today. It was important for us to invite people who act in European trade unions to talk to us about how to build a social Europe without the civil society and the partnerships we have with the civil society. And this also echoes what we have discussed with the Greens in France, and debate that is led within the European Party regarding the labor market and the digitization of the economy. What are the answers we can bring? There was an article this week regarding employment that might increase or might decrease, but there are professions that are going to disappear, cashiers, bankers, people at working in banks, among others, and this represents a certain category of the population, which will perhaps be more affected than other categories. So I'm going to question you today about how you perceive the evolution of the labor market in Europe and why it's important to think about this question on a European level. Is there really a link between what is going on in the European Union and the development of the labor market today? Thank you. Thank you for your invitation. And like every good researcher, I will rely on my PowerPoint, which I had prepared. But because there is no way to present them here, I'm going to try and be very simple and straightforward. So of course, the Industrial Revolution and the digitalization of the economy. Of course, your campaign is going to be based on social media, so we observe that new technologies have modified the way that we communicate and the production process, even how political parties act and communicate. So you see, we live in an ultra-connected world. We see the Internet of Objects. We see the multiplication of networks, of platforms, collaborative economy, shared economy. We hear a lot about artificial intelligence and robots. You perhaps have heard about Watson, which is a new product developed by IBM that is capable of even speaking in TV shows and answer any questions that may be put to it. So it's a good example of the evolution of artificial intelligence. And there's also one word that is ubiquitous today, and that is smart. Everything now is smart. It was just the smartphone, now it's the smart city, smart energy, smart cars, smart transport, smart factories, et cetera, et cetera. Thanks to artificial intelligence, everything is becoming intelligent. And last but not least, there is something to add to the puzzle of digitalization of the economy, which is the new procedure for creating things, which are 3D printers, which perhaps appeared rather like an anecdote initially. But today, you know that in the States there is a debate around the potential creation of making of weapons using 3D printers. And these are weapons that are not toys, but weapons that can actually be used as weapons. So we observe that everything is affected by the evolution of digitalization and the new economy, which some people call the fourth industrial revolution. Now, we at the European Intersyndical Institute, we're trying to think about how everything affects the labor market and what is going to happen on this level. Research has shown us that impacts are potentially enormous. You may have heard of studies that were carried out in English universities, Anglophile universities, and how this may affect up to 47% of employment and perhaps even beyond 50% of employment within 20 years. So this is the phenomenon of automation of everything and how robots can take over. How to the list that was mentioned before, we can add all the professions that are linked to transport. We're talking about automatic boats, automatic cars, or self-driven airplanes. So we can imagine that there's a series of professions that will become obsolete and that for which people will not be necessary anymore in order to function. And this affects factories as well as companies. So I will call this robotization. I have to explain this several times. And I make two categories. One is robotization, and the other is crowd. We talk about crowdsourcing, crowdfunding. So we have the platform economy as opposed to robotization. And the digital platforms allow us to outsource an increasing number of tasks. This is something that is not necessarily very developed here in Europe, but in some countries, work on the internet or through the internet is increasingly developed. I read a study that stated that over 25% of Americans worked via a platform, be it Deliveroo, Upwork, for example, where you can do tasks for companies that outsource certain tasks and for which you will be paid, among other examples. So I personally tested one of these platforms, a European platform. It's a German one that has a certain number of sub-companies in other countries. And I was asked to write an article on the Macron reforms. They wanted an article of 350 words that would be published on a website belonging to French lawyers in Paris. So I wrote this text. It was accepted. And I was paid €4.62. So this is this new way of outsourcing work that exists today and which is pushing towards the decreasing of people's wages, because how can people live and how can journalists survive on such a small sum? So if you look at robotization and if you look at the crowd jobs that I was talking about before, you see that the future of social legislation in Europe regarding collective conventions, health and security at work, collective dismissals, all that exists today as a basic framework that encompasses labor market legislation could be surpassed and undermined by robotization. So I think that we are developing a certain understanding of what is going on, and I think that we need to request that the European Union react, because these are problems and issues that go beyond borders and have to be treated on an international basis and at a European level, at least. We have to find solutions and answers to all our questions on a European level, to all the questions that are going to be put to us by robotization and the digitalization of companies. I can't, of course, give all the answers here and describe the problem in more detail here, but you can go onto the internet and find out a lot more. Thank you. Thank you very much. Be it living together with SCA or living together with digitalization and robotization, as described by Mr. De Gries, all of this requires that we continue living together and debate about all of this as a whole. Perhaps it implies a decrease of democracy and might imply the emergence of the extreme right in Europe. And one thing I was very interested in, which Adam and I don't necessarily agree on, has been discussed in Europe, and it is the failure of the European Union to face technocrats and the issues such as those relating to Greece. However, the situation is a little different today with the populist movements that have attained certain important positions in government, but also certain rights that are disappearing in Poland and Hungary, for example. We see that journalists are also losing their lives in Malta and in Slovenia. There's a lot of corruption that we have to try to avoid. And in certain Western countries like France, we have to continue to fight for the rule of law. In Germany, certain ecologists are defending what democracy is, and not only as an ideology, but as a reality. I read recently that democracy has to be a fraternity, otherwise it is a failure or harmful. So can you tell us a little more, please?
Merci pour l'invitation. Thank you for having me. I do not think European Union is particularly democratic. Neither are member states. If you have a passion for democracy, if you really want more democracy, you are never satisfied, which means that no existing polity is ever democratic enough. And this may sound very theoretical and abstract, but actually that's very important as a starting point. We need to say goodbye to a common misunderstanding. Usually in the political science, they say that there are democratic systems, but democracy is no property of a system, is no property in many meanings of the word property. Democracy is a dimension that emerges when people struggle for things they find important. They fight for them. sometimes very concrete things, sometimes some abstract liberties, but there is always this fight that begins the process. And then the systems of power accommodate. And that's how what we call democratic institutions emerge. And now, if we look at the European Union and member states nowadays, we can see that it's not about states and the Union. It's about people who have some interests, some dreams, some passions, and they use some levels of struggle to follow their dreams. So, for example, now in Poland, I wouldn't say that Poland is less democratic than European Union, or vice versa. But many people in Poland find that European Commission may be an ally in their struggle to have a right to a just, impartial judgment in court. And that's an important cause. Like, if you are a citizen of a country, you don't want the judgment at the court to be rigged by definition. Of course, we don't have just courts in Poland. We didn't have just courts before the current government came in. We have many problems with judiciary. But we also know, most people can see it, even the supporters of the government, that with the so-called reforms imposed by the government, every judge will be expected to report to the Minister of Justice. And they know that it's not in their best interest. So now European Commission comes as an ally. But some 6 years ago, when there was a struggle against ACTA in Europe, European Commission was an enemy. And the Polish government, that was under pressure from the civil society, from the social protests, was an ally. When we talk about, for example, directive on data retention, now it has been invalidated by the European Court of Justice, but it was a valid law for years in Europe. It had been before invalidated by two constitutional courts in far east of the Europe, Romania and Bulgaria, if I remember correctly. So people sometimes use European Commission to fight for their rights, sometimes they use their national governments to fight for their rights. And democracy is when people really are able to have their voice heard. Now, if you want to have some more general conclusions, I believe there is something that combines what Ska was talking about and Christoph was talking about and the topic that you assigned to myself. I would say that the umbrella of thinking about these issues is a protective vision of Europe. And I know that Europe that protects is not a slogan invented by the Greens, but it is a very green slogan, and especially taking into account that the inventor of the slogan, that is President Macron, is not famous of being able to protect a thing. It's very important when we talk about refugee issues or about democracy and also social issues that we should avoid the strict father narrative. We should avoid talking about rules that should be followed, punishments that would follow if you don't follow the rules, obligations that you have, fears. We shouldn't ever make people afraid. Even about the climate change, there are better narratives than making people afraid, because fear triggers the strict father narrative. And when the strict father narrative is triggered, then conservatives and populists, right-wing populists, win. So we need to provide a different umbrella. And this idea of protection is actually a very green idea and very progressive idea. So people want to be protected. Also, their freedoms need to be protected. And we can use Europe sometimes to protect the freedoms and rights we have or we want to have. But we should never pretend that there is more democracy in Europe than there really is. So we should also be very honest in our account of what Europe can provide and what use we can make of it.
Alors je me tourne vers Sébastien Mabille.
I'm going to address Sébastien Mabille. I forgot to say that you were in charge of the EUCM, which is an organization that has existed for many years and is very important for the protection of fauna and flora and natural species.
Là, on a parlé de plusieurs aspects. Il y a certaines personnes qui abordent.
There are several aspects that we have discussed. And some people approach issues from an environmental point of view only. We know, however, as ecologists, that everything is linked. Some people try to relate to issues only on environmental. From an environmental point of view, I wanted to ask you what your thoughts are on this and how you consider this question not only in France, but as a more general ideology. And what we discussed yesterday during the plenary session at lunchtime regarding the ecologization of nature, there's an approach that aims to give rights to nature, and how is this going to change our life? What is the long-term vision regarding this? Thank you, Marie. I'm very happy to be here today. I'm going to briefly test you to see if you're all awake. I'm going to give you three sentences. And if you agree with a sentence in general, then please applaud. If you don't, don't. Market doesn't guarantee the integral development of the human and social inclusion. Second sentence, there are not two crises, an environmental one and a social one, but only one complex crisis that is social and environmental. Third sentence and last one, it is fundamental to search for global solutions that find natural solutions within each other and with including social solutions. Okay, so you have applauded three times in a row and applauded the Pope. And indeed, for many, and by reading certain extracts, it is possible to applaud the Pope and what he has stated. But it is also possible to worry, and this is what I want to get to worry about movements that pertain to the far right, that are into and that use ecology to develop the papal concepts regarding that of integral ecology, which is what is done by the Greens, or has been done by the Greens for already over 10 years. But I don't know if the Pope knows about politics and ecology today. But we have a movement that emerged in 2014, where in the Figaro, a member of a movement against marriage for everyone, which invited people to fight for their
With what we talk about human ecology and with the meetings where they brought together more than 5 or 6 times the amount of people in this room. And we also talk about a sort of society, sort of from Margaret Atwood's novel, we have a sort of anticipation in a polluted world. We go back to nature, we come back to the fundamentals and to the basis of woman who is procreation. So it's a joke, a second degree joke, just in case. The right, when we're talking about Europe, is very, very important, it's strong. And the first question is this Catholic right likely to operate a sort of hold-up of the ecological values here? We know that ecology is a science of life, and if we say that ecology is science of life, we end up seeing that ecology is the science of divine creation. And this is what the Pope says when he states that man is the collaborator of God in the creation of ecology. And maybe you're going to not to applaud the Pope. It is worrying that some ecological movements demand a certain limit to scientific research, do not apply the same to human life. And through this limit, we're talking about another reactionary movement, and they published in 2014 a work which was called No Limit for an Integral Ecology. And before the publication of the Pope's words, called for the acknowledgement of the limits so that we end up having the characteristics of basic ecology. So the expression common essence rather than morale, and then we end up with Leo Ferrer's words, never forget that what is immoral is the morale of others. Then can ecology be a Trojan horse to impose a new moral inspired by the very reactionary Catholic Church movements? Ecology is science of the interactions of life. Interactions favor diversity, or they help diversity. And we see that we have an ecosystem which is connected to others and plays some interaction with other human living. And ecology is usually good help. A population of animals which is isolated from the others will eventually disappear. So when we study nature, we have to stress and protect the interaction, interrelations. And quoting Jonas, which is our inspiration, says the same thing when he said the same thing when he conceptualized the definition: act in such a way that the effects of your action be compatible with the sustainability of human life on Earth. This leads us to reflect on the effects on the action and not on the action itself. The effects are in fact interaction. So ecology is also more freedom, enables the others to live. And Jonas said, we only have the right to choose the non-being of the future generations because of the being of the current generation. So ecology means that everybody has to choose or be able to choose, be able to live what they want to live without disease. And that supposes rights which were transferred to human beings. And that's why we have the European Court of Human Rights. We're not far from it. And it has become a major convention to protect ecologies, because while protecting the human rights, we protect the environment. While protecting human rights, the environment, you protect human rights, the right to have to access justice, the right to move, and so on. And those rights are gradually extended to those people who never used to benefit from it, especially children. In the case of climatic justice, Marie is a specialist of this Children Act. They act before the courts to preserve their rights, their capacities to have choices when they're grown up. The first case was in the 90s in the Philippines, and recently there's going to be a court in the next few weeks in the Supreme Court in the US. Stating that link between ecology and freedom, we also have to mention the two important dangers which are on the door of political ecology, faced to, with the emergency to change our ways of behavior. The people who are going to succeed in that transition, in the ecological transition, are the most authoritarian countries, like China, for instance. And we may be concerned that one day, maybe, we're going to say they are more efficient, but freedom does not exist there. But freedom is essential to ecology because it guarantees diversity, but at the same time, we can be concerned, and I go back to Pope Francis, who states that why do we want to preserve a power today that will leave the memories of its incapacity to act when it was necessary and urgent to do it? So yes, we can worry about that because our democratic system cannot perform the ecological transition, so maybe it's going to be thrown down the bin. Because it cannot operate the necessary choices. What we have to talk about is the theory of human ecology, integral ecology, promoted by that part of the right which should become a moral. And the integral authority, which should become a sort of moral, but it doesn't stress the interactions between people, but it promotes the behaviors of the individuals themselves, so preventing the self to become to be able to live one's sexuality and freely take contraceptives, included if they are chemical contraceptives, which means the right to dispose of one's body, which has to be intangible, because freedom and ecology are connected. The solution is, in the end, maybe we should go back to Descartes and Elisabeth Badinter, who used to be a feminist militant, and faced to that question, used to oppose, stating that I am, I think like Descartes, but thinking of freedom is far more leads to far more freedom than the reactionary. But today, reality is completely different, and men, who was the owner and master of nature, submitted it to its needs, is a danger for a common house. Pope Francis brings forth his solution, saying that the best way to put men back to its place and end its pretensions of dominating the world is to show that God is there. Otherwise, human being will always tend to impose his own rights and interests. So whether we talk about Descartes and the Pope, we always refer to a master. And if faced with those threats, maybe we should change our paradigm and think our relations to the others in a different way, conferring rights to any category of human beings, and being careful, protect them. And we just have to protect that vital connection linking humans to non-humans. And we hear about relative universalism, which means that relations rather than quality should be the form of a new universalism of values. And in the role of commissioner, the humans should not be the main ones, but they would be the diversified representatives of various natures, and they cannot be cut off from that. And if the acknowledgement of our rights in favor of new categories of human beings constitutes a vision which is far more enthusiastic than going back to a creator God, which is unique and created the world and brings more freedom, rather than what should be imposed, and saying that we have to submit to ecology. The solution should be inclusive to everything around us. And faced with the new challenges today in Europe and in the campaign, there's an emerging question: is give new rights to the categories of human beings, whether we're talking about flowers, animals, ecosystems, woods, and is far more enthusiastic and exciting than the past, which associated ecology and liberty.
Donc on a fait une petite plongée un peu analyse et prospective.
So we went through prospective and analytical situation with Pope Francis. The question before us is that we should analyze the developments of the world around us and be able to answer. For 1 year, we have been working on the project and program for the European elections. We did it in France, and we have the project team here. We have Marie Pochon and they are here, and we suggested a contribution of about 20 pages for to the European project, and we're still going to work in it so that we can adopt it later on. We also worked on the European level, and we saw proposals emerge, which we call key proposals, and they are diverse, and we still have to work on them, and we come across the rights of nature, the rights to give more power to the European courts to fight corruption, to have binding decisions to promote democracy. We want to set up a social protection on the European level so that we have maternity leave, for instance, which is common in all European countries and so on. So there are many, many proposals, and there are many measures to be taken so that we can start a society which is more equal, more social, more democratic, and of course more environmental. And we have to sort various things out, and we see that the political landscape as it is today is neoliberal, and we're also facing populism and nationalism from the right and from the left, like the Five Star Movement, jumping into the League of the North in Italy, and have a battle for the migrants, because we also think each time that we also know that each time we put forward with the argument that there are also poor people in France and they have to be protected. Amongst all the fights we have to lead in the 5 years, so if the people, all the heads of state are not particularly ecologists, whether we talk about whatever party we talk about, but we need the votes of the citizens, and we know that's going to be difficult to lead the political battle within the institutions in Europe. So what are the key measures we have to concentrate on, and how can we lead those battles to win a few, which are the battles that we know we are going to lose but have to work on and nevertheless. So can I ask you to react as an expert in your field, and so that we can So which are those battles in your fields of expertise? And we can also broaden the approach a little bit so that Sébastien can brief. We can start with Adam.
Thank you. I believe that the most important struggle now and the biggest opportunity for the Green family in Europe is giving substance to the European idea of social rights. We know that what has been produced at the European level is like an empty shell. It's an empty promise. There is not much substance to it. But there is the promise. And this promise gives us opportunity to make it more concrete and also to make it more ecological in content. So not just to fight for social rights to be meaningful, but also to be anchored in a more sustainable vision of society and economy. Now I believe that the biggest trap in fighting for Europe is to make Europe the topic. And I invite you to make a thought experiment. Let's imagine we are back in 2005. But an alternative version of history. The convention came with a bold proposal. Not constitution treaty for Europe, but social and environmental pact for Europe. With European unemployment insurance, European minimum wage, basics of a European labor code for posted workers, European work-life balance solutions, solutions to fight energy poverty, common European fund for just transition of mining regions. And on the top of it, not a flag, not a hymn, not symbols, not a constitution, but a small European tax to fund all this. Very small one, for a start. Now, please imagine, you are in 2005. How do you feel campaigning for this? Who are the opponents of this? What the opponents of this are saying? How they may try to convince people that more workers' rights and more environmental security would be actually bad for them? What would be the result of this fight? So that, I believe, is crucial. Europe will not seduce people if it is so busy with itself. Europe will seduce people if they see that Europe is busy solving their problems and upgrading the quality of their lives, protecting it. So I believe that's the biggest challenge, to convince, not just to convince people that Europe is it, but also to make Europe deliver on it, not be an empty promise. But also not to fall into traps of opposing pro-European and anti-European forces in a very blunt way, because that's not the way to go. I was supportive of Constitution for Europe in 2005, but now I regret, because I believe it was a travesty of 19th century nationalism, just upgraded to another level. We really need to make it meaningful first, to make it deliver first, and then it will work for us all. So that's my short message. Let's give the social rights some substance. Let's show that Europe actually can protect people from many dangers that are there around, but not focusing too much on the dangers, because triggering fear is not a good way to go. And let's not fight on the ground of Europe, for Europe or against Europe. Let's fight for the Europe that will make people's lives meaningful.
I would say that the two main priorities are what is necessary for life, it's climate and biodiversity. And I think that on the one hand, we have to call the end of a break, projects for mines in Guyana and projects for motorways as here in Strasbourg, those which are not sanctioned. The European courts must have environmental jurisdiction, ecocide crime, crime to for aggression against biosphere. All this must be sanctioned, and the attacks against the environment. And we must stop externalizing all the economic activities, for instance, pesticides. The society as a whole has to bear the huge costs of the loss of bees, of birds, and so on. In a survey published in France in spring, 30% of the songs of birds have disappeared. The same insects in 80% of the insects died in Germany, and this is going to have some costs which are going to be unbearable for society. And this system works because the companies that make a profit on such environmental problems like Bayer, Monsanto, and so on, they do not internalize the whole costs. But if they had to internalize the costs, or if they were forced to, that's what we're trying to get through the judge. In this case, this economic model, particularly the agricultural model, would not be economically profitable. So priority is to act on the two basic themes, because if we do not act, or if we act too late, human life will be compromised. So maybe planet, the whole planet will not survive, but civilization as we know it today will not. Thank you.
Merci.
Thank you. I agree with Adam said regarding social rights. I am personally convinced that there will be no Europe, there will be no political Europe, there will be no European Union without a social Europe, simply because populations will not support a project that is not solidary and fraternal. I may be completely wrong, but that is my personal conviction. I also have a vision that is rather pessimistic regarding the future, because I think that the more challenges are urgent, the more the tools that we have seem to be weak. According to several studies we did at the European Trade Union Institute, since 10 or 15 years, the social European social right has been slowly eroding. There are no new social directives at the European level. The social rights are revised, but weakened. So that is my observation. And I don't think there's anything in the political movement these days that is very inspiring and or positive change. Secondly, regarding social rights, there's also the European Social Dialogue, which went through a golden age in the 90s and early 2000s, but since 10 years approximately, this system is not functioning anymore, mainly because of employers who consider that social dialogue is not useful to create a social dialogue, but useful for employees to just put up with developments and decreasing of social rights. So I think what is important to develop social rights within Europe is to develop new dynamics, but sadly they are weakening rather than strengthening. So I think that what is at stake now is exactly this, and this is linked to the environment, of course, and ecology. I think that mobilization is something that is still effective today. For example, 15 years ago, there were huge protests at a European level that brought together between 200,000 and 400,000 people when we had the European Council meetings. And I think that these protests had a huge impact on how leaders perceived political issues. There are some movements that were very strong and strongly opposed to certain decisions. And I think that these protests are lost. They don't seem to exist anymore these days. In Brussels, there were European protests on a yearly basis, and today these are very rare. So I think we have to think of new links. Of course, I talk about trade unions because that's my field, but that's not the only possibility. We have to create new alliances to mobilize people and get them involved in politics. So I just like to remind people that I'm here and we as trade unions exist.
I'm not at all so pessimistic at all. I mean, I hang out in Brussels a lot. We have a lot of demonstrations. Of course, you have to look at who's coming. And of course, it's more impressive when the farmers come with their tractors. But we have a lot of demonstrations. Also, civil society and labor unions are getting more, let's say, professional, even though that sounds a bit silly, are getting more into the spaces where they are able to change things. So, I mean, I'm all for big demonstrations because I think really mobilization, public mobilization, is the one thing that really, really works. But I wouldn't be so pessimistic on things. That same goes for the topics that I would, my very non-exhaustive list of things we really need to work on, not just in the next 5 years or so, but really now. And for me, the number one there is climate change, because we don't have any time to lose, because it's really high time to move. Thank you. But also because I think people have finally understood. I mean, this summer has brought a discussion from Sweden to Greece about climate change because the forests were burning. The farmers are complaining about losses in their harvesting. So it's a huge topic, and a lot of people have seen it, not just maybe for the first time, not just as a wow, hot summer, but really as, this might really have something to do with climate change. So I think we have right now a good momentum, and we can't let this lose, we can't lose it. You know, if we're now saying, okay, let's think about climate change, you know, next spring or something. No, we have to do it now when everyone is really talking about it. But we do have a possibility because right now it's in everyone's heads and people understand that maybe it's cool to have a nice summer, but at some point it really gets too much and we should really do something about climate change. So I do think we have a possibility to act there. And secondly, also social Europe. Absolutely. For me, that's the big thing where we need to start going. I mean, on climate change, we have at least a sort of, it's sort of on the agenda somewhere in the drawer. And social Europe isn't really. Though also I don't agree that we've been not doing, like not getting anywhere. For the first time, for example, in the past half year, we've managed to put the principle of equal pay for equal work at the equal like place into European law, and that has been missing for a long time, and it's such an essential thing of social justice, and we finally managed to do that. Huge, big success. We're very proud of that. Also, I mean, in the whole battle of the rights of mainly lorry drivers, we're not at the end yet, but we've managed so far to stop really bad things from happening, so that is something where we're hopeful for the next few weeks and months to be successful. And I also would see social Europe a bit more broadly. I totally agree with what Adam has mentioned as examples, but for me it's also things like tax justice. also there we've been moving ahead, obviously not as fast as we should and really need to, but we've been moving ahead in the discussion in taxing big companies and also looking now into plastic tax and stuff like this. Again, not at all as far going as we need to, but this is areas that for me are also part of social things, the whole taxation issue, fair taxation, making sure that companies pay their taxes. And also, if we have a social Europe, then this cannot only be inward looking. I mean, a big part of social issues is this whole globalization issue. How do we deal with trade? By the way, that's also very much linked to climate, of course. Can't leave that out there. So this is something we need to look at. Like, how do we deal with the globalization that is happening? Which parts don't we want? Which parts is anyway going to happen? And what do we do about that? And how do we ensure social rights in this context? And how do we also make sure that we're not stripping other people of their social rights by, for example, importing super cheap, you know, clothes or soya or whatever. And mainly, maybe thirdly on my very non-exhaustive list is the whole issue of democracy and civil liberties, because there we really have currently a big, big need inside the European Union. And it is people who are not at all happy with their governments, be it in Romania, for example, latest example, but not just there. And they do look to the European Commission, which can be an ally in this situation. Not just the Commission, also the European institutions as such really need to be the ally, because people are saying, okay, my government is not helping me. They're actually the enemy in this. Like, who do I turn to in order to have my rights secured? And they turn to Europe, which I think is a big honor, but it's also a big responsibility. And currently we don't have yet the instruments of how to deal with that, because we have a very close look at countries that want to join the European Union, but once they're in, you know, they're in. You're in the club, and then you might not really get the peer review that you need to have. So we need to expand there a bit on instruments. We have Greens have a couple of ideas there. I'll leave that out now, but I do think that this issue of how do we ensure democracy, good governments, civil liberties inside our own European Union area, that is one of the big things we need to work on, and where we have probably more question marks still than on the other two issues that I've mentioned. And how to do that? It's public pressure. Public pressure means, yes, demonstrations, but it can also mean very simple things like all of us, you know, writing a personal email to a deputy. We have European elections coming up May next year, and that's a perfect time in the campaign always to go and ask candidates what they think about it. And because, I mean, nobody probably ever shows up at some conservative candidate rally and asks, so what do you think about climate change? Or will you agree to this or that? Will you sign the agreement with Japan or not? And I think that's also a form of public pressure, which is often underlooked and which can be done without 100,000 people behind me, because these are often very difficult to rally. And yes, so for me, allies, not just, but especially outside parliamentary structures, like all these little initiatives that are everywhere, you know, those people that really are the Green Europe for me, like the people who stand up for their rights and for other people's rights, and they do that in really difficult circumstances. And those are our allies, and that's why I'm not so pessimistic.
Merci, Ska.
Thank you, Ska. I think it's nice to hear from one of our leaders of negotiations that it's still possible to act despite a somber future, according to some. You have been very good. We are in good time. And I'm going to ask the audience to be understanding with what is going to follow. We have three suggestions with the French Greens for the future, and we are debating these at the moment. And I wanted to discuss these, perhaps to get your opinion, be it not binding, just to find out what you think. The first, perhaps, regards robotization and the digitalization of the economy. in France, there was a debate back in the time of the election. The ecologists consider that rare metals are few and far between, and that robots are still not, they're not enough. So I think that perhaps we need to view the problem from the with the vision that there are limits to what the planet can provide for us. And to come back to the main question, which is, what do we do in a world where there is no work? What do we do with robotization? And do we propose a basic revenue for everybody? Do we give it to young people? Do we give it to the poor, the less wealthy? So I ask your opinion on this. The second question regards the difference between the European Greens and the French Greens, which is, as we have seen, that one of the environmental challenges, and I would just like to take advantage of this to talk about the 10 families who have are plaintiffs and who consider that the European Union is not acting to defend the climate. There is a petition, an online petition that you can sign, in fact. And this brings us back to what Sebastian was saying about biodiversity. We, of course, have to, we depend on animal well-being and the enlargement of protected spaces is one of the propositions that we want to make for France and for Europe, because we need a biological continuity for the years to come. The third issue, but of course you can answer to any of these as you wish, regarding our approach to the European institutions, are they democratic or not? How do we improve them? How do we improve citizens' participation? How can we take into account the limit of what the world can give us, and not only act through austerity? And what we think that the treaties should be revised. We call it the constituency. We think that citizens should participate on a personal level, individual level, and as cities, towns, and constituencies. I would like to know what you think regarding these issues. These are three suggestions we are making, and this will lead to a new discussion, perhaps, because this is something that is open to public debate. Does someone want to contribute? Very quickly, and then I will be quiet. Regarding taxes, I think we need to review the system from A to Z. Talking about taxes for robots is difficult, because it is easy to think of the answer. Of course, we want to tax technological progress, or so taxing robots is not the better approach. I think what we are announcing, that there is going to be higher production and gain at that level, better income. So the question is, how are we going to redistribute this increased income and this increased productivity? Now, the problem is that today everybody's talking about this increased productivity, but no one actually sees the fruit of this. So strategically, we haven't quite found the right approach. And the more interesting approach, the more beneficial one. there's another way of redistributing profit and income, which could be a collective reduction of working hours. It is something that we don't question, just as if we thought it was impossible. And this also within trade unions, because I have participated in debates where people don't even understand the idea. Some people want to increase working hours. So I think there's a real issue that needs to be discussed here. It should be discussed at the European level and within trade unions and also by civil society.
Yeah, I agree with that. We should really be more a bit out of the box and open thinking about how we want to live and, well, live and work is a bit silly. How we want to live in the future. And I mean, working is something we do in our life, but it's not what we live for. At least we really shouldn't, especially politicians. And I think there we really also have to make sure that these new technologies, that they work in the benefit of people and nature, not to the contrary, and they think they can be helpful, they can also do the other thing. We need to regulate that they're only going to do, so to say, the good things. And for that, we need to have clear rules, because robotics, you mentioned the 3D printers earlier, well, they can print either a leg prosthesis or they can print a weapon. So it's not as such that the printer is evil, it's what you do with it. And that, I think, is what we need to regulate. The second thing, by basic income, I'm personally very much in favor. I know, but that's obviously not going to solve all our problems, but I think to have a social system which is not entirely linked to, it's not linked to that you're worth something because you've been working or you're working, that is something that I'm looking at very sympathetically. Thank you. I think the second one, Marie, you were saying that that there's different approaches to either focus really on climate or focus more on the nature and environment things. I don't know if I would really see such a... I think you have to do all of it. You have to talk about climate, because if climate change is going to happen, then like the bees and the butterflies also going to die from that. And on the other hand, for example, protected areas can also really function as a carbon sink and are extremely important in the fight against climate change. So for me, that's not really a contradiction. Of course, it's also a question of where you put your effort, but I think climate change is something that is also bringing the importance of nature, of environment, of environmental protection back into people's minds. So maybe that's even a good angle to start with. And lastly, on this whole issue of, do we want to have a convention, like reinvent Europe? Absolutely, totally, I'm all for it, but I would not wait for it. There are some people who are saying, oh, everything sucks, and we first need to have a convention, we need to make a new treaty, and then we're going to have a fabulous Europe. I don't want to wait for that. Also, because at this convention, there's also going to be people sitting who are currently voting in elections, so I'm not sure the majorities are going to be 70% green or something. And also because with our current treaties and laws, we can do so many things. We even have to do them. We can help people in need. We can show solidarity to Greece, for example. We can have a social Europe without having to change the treaties. So yes, I'm all for changing the treaties, but I wouldn't wait for it. And I'm very tired of people that uses, obviously no one here, but sometimes in the debate you hear like, oh, but first we need to change the treaties and then everything's going to be better. Like, no, I mean, maybe, but maybe not. Let's do things that we can do right now and let's not wait for some other day to come.
I am convinced that the notion of limits that you were talking about earlier is integrated in the reflection on robotization is essential, but I don't think it's the only debate. We have one indicator regarding the day of going beyond limits, which was this year, the 4th of August, I can't remember, where it was considered that we had gone through all the resources that we have. But we certainly have indicators that the limits have been now. We have gone beyond the limits, and I think that our limits are way beyond what I was discussing earlier, and we talk about limits relating to the planet. I think it is essential that we have to integrate and understand these limits, even though it is very difficult. Regarding the second suggestion, when we talk about giving, making some of Europe wild again, in a sense, I think that it is important to do so, yes, although the choice of terms is a little complicated. I saw something recently regarding the questions to French citizens regarding the integration or the release of bears in the French Pyrenees, and a lot of the citizens were prepared to accept that bears should be reintegrated into the Pyrenees. So I think that the question of biodiversity and the relationship with nature is something essential, and that has to be discussed, but of course has to be discussed in relation to climactic change, and I think that this is very complicated. Very recently, I was in Africa, where there are a lot of parks and protected areas that contribute to biodiversity because of the oxygen they produce. Of course, people want to go there and visit, but they have to get there, and that, of course, is polluting. Similarly, we have debates around the use of wind turbines because of their pollution and the danger that they represent for bats. So there's also always two sides to the story, and it's also a double-edged sword very often. So we have to manage all the difficulties that we are faced with, but most questions are very complex. But regarding protected areas and increasing them, yes, of course, I agree.
With the Constituent Assembly, I am very skeptical. It's a noble idea, but it's also a trap of putting the cart before the horses. We were already at this place with Prodi Commission, progressive majority in the council. I believe the years were lost. Like, we could have used them better. With universal basic income, I believe I am a skeptical supporter of this idea. I believe we need to be open-minded also about other solutions like shorter working time or work guarantee. But there is one thing about universal basic income that makes me passionate about it. I don't know if it's a solution to our problems, but it contradicts the basic ideological conviction that I believe is a fundament of fascism, which is that you need to deserve your life, you need to deserve your dignity. You don't need to deserve your life, you don't need to deserve your dignity. And that's why talking about universal basic income is really very important, even if finally we find this as a solution, or we may find some other solutions. But we need to keep to this basic conviction that dignity and right to life is not something you must earn. With climate change and environmental protection, I believe that's not the opposition. The opposition is between two affects. One is the affect of fear. And when times are peaceful, environment is clear, then there are not many troubles. Ecologists are perceived as those who create problems. We know that we just bring problems to attention, but for the general public, it may be, it may look like ecologists are really creating the problems we are talking about. So fear is a trap for us. But in times of, like Ska mentioned, of floods, droughts, terrible weather problems, when the problems are palpable, we may be perceived as those who bring protection. And that's really the opportunity for us. Just we need to leave aside our attachment that some of us have to talk fear and talk more about protection and solutions, because we are not those who create environmental problems. We are those who offer solutions to them and who offer people and societies protection from their consequences.
Eh bien, je vous remercie tous les quatre.
Thank you to all four of you. This is the we are reaching the end of our plenary session. I hope that this has brought new ideas to you and that will lead to more thinking and help you develop your thinking. Next, we have a workshop and discussion on inequality in schools. So I invite you to come and discuss social inequalities in schools.